Hello and welcome to this little island amid the ocean that YouTube is. If you watched my previous video regarding the oldest bookstore in the world, you may remember I mentioned the bookstore, like many others, had been destroyed in 1755 as Lisbon was severely affected by an earthquake. An earthquake felt in Europe, yet that affected Lisbon so much that it's currently known as Lisbon Earthquake of 1755. November 1st, 1755, All Saints' Day. The holiday started as per usual, with many leaving their homes and attending Mass. Then, at around 9:40 a.m., an intense earthquake hit Lisbon. According to historical reports, the earthquake lasted around 7 to 9 minutes, with 3 waves of shakes with short intervals between them. Historical reports, known as the Inquérito, were commissioned by Marquis Pombal and consisted of the registry of what was observed by the survivors. These records questioned the direction of movement and the duration of the shakes, thus allowing for an estimation of the earthquake intensity and the knowledge of what areas were more affected. Crossing the historical reports with today's knowledge in the field of seismology, it is estimated the 1755 earthquake had a magnitude between 8.5 and 9 in the scale of Richter. At first, a bang was heard, a kind of thunder, and then the first tremor, lasting slightly more than a minute. Many witnesses speak of a sensation similar to riding giant chariots or thousands of galloping horses. Other witnesses compare the rumble to a herd of elephants. After a short interval, not over a minute, they felt a second tremor with greater violence. It lasted about 2 minutes and the first houses began to fall. The roofs and sobrados collapsed and the plaster bounced off the walls. Walls opened up and towers fell. The third quake followed, and this is when testimonies are more diffuse. Almost all claim that most of the damaged houses collapsed at this stage. The collapsed buildings cast a suffocating cloud of dust over the city, darkening the streets and blocking out the sunlight. Most witnesses speak of a total duration of 6 to 9 minutes. Some mention only 2 tremors, not distinguishing the second from the third. Between 60 to 90 minutes after the earthquake, as flames and destruction took over the city, survivors ran towards the Tagus River. Yet safety was not closer, as a tsunami with waves of around 5 meters high flooded the city riverside. The debris the tsunami washed up clogged the streets and fed the fires. Escaping seemed impossible. According to Quake's website, specialists have not yet agreed which fault or set of faults may have caused the 1755 earthquake, since if it was a single fault, it had to be at least 100 kilometers long and 50 kilometers wide. Otherwise, it would have to be 2 or more large faults rupturing in sequence, which according to historical information on the tsunami, it suggests that when combined, the fault would have a 200 kilometers in length and 80 kilometers wide. Virtually all of the city's major structures suffered extensive damage. Of Lisbon's 40 churches, all sustained some structural damage, while 35 were completely destroyed. Of the 75 convents, only 10 were left intact. One of 7 old age homes remained inhabitable, and none of the prisons or hospitals escaped unscathed. Nor was the nobility spared. 33 palaces were reduced to rubble, most of which were focal points of the neighborhoods in which they were situated. The arsenal, the river palace, the royal library, and the patriarchal palace were all destroyed. Perhaps most startling, of approximately 20,000 housing units in the city, only 14,000 remained habitable. While no exact tally of the total losses was ever made, it was estimated that approximately 10% of the nation's wealth was consumed by the earthquake's devastation. With the king's inability to govern, José de Carvalho e Melo, Marquês de Pombal, became the de facto leader during the crisis. With the king's approval, martial law was installed, and under Marquês de Pombal's direction, for a food distribution system was applied, no one was allowed to leave the city, as all were to contribute to the city cleanup. Reluctantly, the church approved the burial of the dead in mass graves in order to avoid the spread of diseases. A zero-tolerance rule was applied. Thus, looters and other criminals were executed, with the lucky ones forced to work in the city cleanup. An inventory was made with exact descriptions and measurements of the buildings, public spaces and roads, with the task often becoming difficult due to the frequent competing claims for the same property. Huts and shacks were built, with the business owners rushing to get back in business, with little to no regard to site planning, hygiene and density limitations. In order to halt unorganized constructions, a decree was issued on December 30, 1755 that prohibited building within the city while the inventory was being undertaken. Although the prohibition was eventually forced to be lifted, Pombal would order in 1760 the demolition of all buildings that did not meet the planning specifications. The reconstruction of the city would be financed through funds of several European nations and Brazil, as well as through a 4% tax on all trade and manufacture. Some of the main architects of Lisbon reconstruction were General Manuel da Maia, Captain Eugenio dos Santos, Lieutenant Colonel Carlos Martel, José Monteiro de Carvalho, João Pedro Ludovice, and Reinaldo Manuel. As Maia began the planning of the city, he submitted three concept papers to Pombal which outlined the site planning, the reconstruction and design options. Within it, there were four planning options designed by different teams of architectural engineers. The first option offered no change, as it limited itself in reconstructing the city at the image of what it was before. The second option had little to no change in density, but suggested the widening of the streets. The third option was based on the total demolition of Baixa and its reconstruction based on a new pattern, with the new construction standards and with a lower density. The fourth option suggested the capital to be built near Belém, which would eventually lead to the abandonment of the old city. All four options were far from being easy solutions. He was appreciative of tradition, of the need to promote the image of the nation and the crown, as well as the need to maintain the unique Lisbonesque quality of life. On the other hand, he was a practical engineer who saw the need to modernize and utilize the most advanced technological innovations. All of his options involved sacrifice. Maia presented his ideas to Pombal, who, after a careful review, selected the clean slate option. Maia had six military architect engineers develop alternative plans for Baixa. Enraged in teams of two, he directed each team to focus on a specific concept, and when the three approaches were created, he shuffled the teams and requested from them three refined plans, in which one would be accepted. The first plan was developed by Walter da Fonseca with the aid of Pinheiro da Cunha, and was to maintain the dimensions of the old structures while the roads and squares were to be realigned. It was a plan with little disruption, quickly implementable, and with minimal costs to the crown. Yet, it failed to reflect the modern sanitization needs. The second plan, which was directed by Captain Elias Sebastião Pope alongside his brother, José Domingos Pope, envisioned a completely new street system with wide avenues. It was a utilitarian plan with emphasis on ease of movement, airflow, and sunlight. Finally, the third plan was a bridge between the two plans mentioned before. It was developed by Eugenio dos Santos, who was aided by AC Andreas, and it was the only one that attempted at forging a strong connection to Terreiro do Passo and Baixa. It maximized the access to the sea and visually provided a clear sense of entry to the center of the city. Nonetheless, it raised significant discussion at the highest levels of government because it called for the partial taking of properties belonging to the church and the nobility, two groups with whom Pombal was already in conflict. Neither plan was eventually considered the one. In fact, they were used for further development of new ones as Maia reconstituted the teams. The fourth plan was presented by Fonseca and addressed some of Maia's concerns. Yet it was deemed unrealistic, and whilst Pope's plan, the sixth plan, was imaginative, its greatest weakness was a redesign of the Terreiro do Passo. Meanwhile, dos Santos and Carlos Martel plan, the fifth plan, allowed the ease of movement, standardized lots, easy parcellation, only minimal church relocation, and opportunities for monumentality. Santos' plan met all the basic conceptual objectives set by Maia and became the basis for the Baixa Pombalina. Through the reconstruction of the city, the focus was not only to quickly recover, but take the chance to rebuild the city in a way that was not only reflective of the modern views of city planning, but that could withstand future disasters such as the one it had just gone through. With so in mind, the so-called Gaiola Pombalina was created. The cage is defined as a wooden structure that, due to its elasticity, can adapt to the movements of the ground when shaken by an earthquake. The cage would resist the movement and detach itself from the masonry that could fall without collapsing the entire building. Another characteristic of these new buildings was the use of firewalls between buildings, which would prevent the fire from quickly spreading from one house to the other. To further improve the building's fire resistance and provide a more hygienic environment, tiles were also applied to the interiors. With the legalization of 1758, the rebuilding of the city began. However, the lack of resources, the land distribution agreements, the construction of infrastructures to support the serial production of prefabricated materials, the removal of debris and the leveling of the land hampered the speed of the works. As of 1777, only 46% of the area that had been the object of the survey had been constructed. Then, with Joseph I's death and consequently Marquês Pombal stepping out of power, Marquês de Angeja, minister of Maria I, suspended the works due to the economic situation of the country. Thus, what was foreseen to have been completed in 5 years lasted more than 5 decades. The Portuguese capital prior to the earthquake of 1755 was a city that reflected much of the organic growth of a settlement with little to no planning. The streets were very narrow and the buildings did not reflect what today we consider to be standard safety measures. This became blatant when monumental constructions such as, at the time, the newly built Opera House, collapsed alongside others. Although tragic, it also allowed for the country to rethink its capital and take the necessary actions to improve it. Worried that such events could once again affect the capital, the reconstruction had to be done thinking on how to prevent the buildings from collapsing and the quick spreading of fire. The key answer was in innovation and science, which contrasted with the heavily religious view that some had. Following the earthquake, some had the opinion that the city was being punished for its sins. Fortunately, Marquês Pombal had a more rational approach. One of the buildings that survived the earthquake is Convento do Carmo, which remains today as a reminder of how easily a city can, regardless of power and money, crumble in the face of nature. Thank you so much for watching. Don't forget to like and subscribe if you enjoyed the video, and let me know your thoughts in the comments below. Do share your knowledge or simply feel free to share a topic you would like me to check. Stay safe!